from an industry perspective, we understand that retailers have all kinds of consumer drivers, and it's all about how we get closer to the customer. In any way, shape, or form, it's that race to the last mile. But what that's doing is it puts a lot of pressure on the operational side of the business while they're investing millions and billions in the e-commerce. There's still stress on the operational side. And what I'm going to try to cover today are some of those stresses that are wrapped up in there. From a refrigerant architecture, I'm not going to go through each one of those choices, but the architectures are changing. But from a service and cold room perspective, there's A1 refrigerants that are used today. There will be some choices in the future. More hydrocarbon as the charges increases, and pure HFOs, A2Ls, mildly flammable gases, that'll make their way with charge limitations. That will happen. We're hearing more about micro-distributed and macro-distributed, where the refrigeration system is self-contained from the compressor, the valve, the control, the filter dryer, the pressure transducer, in each and every case. If it's a 12-foot case and it's got R290 in it, you've got three individual sections to get you that 12-foot case. If you're using HF or HFO blend, you may be, depending on the charge, you may be able to use one unit for all 12 feet. So those are dynamics that the industry is seeing right now. In the centralized side of things, the centralized rack that we know and love, the large centralized racks are going to go CO2, really large stuff in the future. There's still some retrofit opportunities. We'll talk about that in a few minutes. There's Cascade systems. We've heard about Cascade. Typically, it's 134A on the primary side, using 134A DX, because very efficient, high temperature, ambient temperature gas. Retailers in the US have trialed it, but some parts of like Australia, it's still the architecture to use. 134A with CO2, subcritical, low temp, very efficient there. Indirect chillers, where you've got a lot of choice on the refrigerant you use, depending on where that chiller is installed. If that equipment is out on the roof and you've got authority having jurisdiction, there's some systems that are propane, there's some that are ammonia, chilling a CO2 loop and pumping CO2 as a secondary fluid to the medium temp, and using that condensing as well for the low temp cascade CO2. So there's all kinds of different refrigeration architectures for the new side of things. But all of those have energy component. We had a discussion earlier on the energy difference between one and the other, and it's not just about the GWP of the gas, a direct emissions component. There's also an energy component, and that's why we use the life cycle climate performance analysis when we look at differences between different architectures. And that, how do they stack up versus carbon equivalency of one versus the other? But when we're talking about existing equipment, and why is power management important? And it's not, when we look at power today, depending on where you are in the country or in the world, it's not just about kilowatt hours that you're using now. Important, mind you, and we're trying to reduce those kilowatt hours during normal operation as much as possible. But many around the world are being penalized for their peak kilowatt usage on those hottest days of the year. And we know if you got a 20 degree condenser and it's 100 degrees outside, you're going to run 120 condensing. There's no getting away from that. Knowing that, is there something you can do to your system to shift and not meet that 120 condensing? So it's the industry thinking differently with new equipment design, as well as we're looking at their retrofit side of their business. Out of 18 million commercial customers in the US, 5 million are in high peak utility areas that can get up to $15 per kilowatt hour, not 15 cents a kilowatt hour, peak $15 a kilowatt hour. Those that are in those areas are very conscious about peak demand, kilowatts, how to reduce that kilowatt. These are real dynamic concerns, whether it's new or whether it's existing stores. I go to a lot of conferences and I hear individuals talk at the conference, and one of the comments I regularly hear is, it's all great that there's new architecture solutions going forward. They address energy, they address IoT, they bring me lots of data. But 98% of my stores are old. And how do I manage those that old infrastructure? And how do I upgrade that old infrastructure? And how can I take advantage, how can they take advantage of dynamics that are happening whether we like it or not? And think about those dynamics when you retrofit today, how's that gonna impact me in 10 years? Those are important decisions. It's interesting because when you go through that, it's an example, an illustration of you've got solar, you've got traditional power, you've got wind power, you've got large energy users. And here's a scenario. The ISO communicates that the price is about to increase from 10 cents a kilowatt hour to $1 a kilowatt hour unless 100 megawatts is removed from the system. And this large hotel, basically, I'm a hotel, conference underway. I need maximum cooling for my building. I'm looking to buy additional load reduction to avoid the price. So he wants to buy load reduction so he doesn't get charged. Whereas you've got a big box store that's saying, you know what, I've got variable fan speeds, I got RTUs. I can shift my loads for 10 minutes and provide you that relief that you have. And by doing that, they get paid to do that. Imagine if you had 100 of those assets that you can shift all 100 at the same time and provide tremendous benefit, they'll pay you for that. We had to prove that we can do that. But that's the different mindset that's required today. It's not enough to just manage my refrigeration within that space, within that building, within that envelope. I've got lighting, I've got heating, HVAC, demand ventilation. I don't want to overly bring in fresh air. I've got all of this to worry about, lighting. It's taking that entire ecosystem into one architect and dynamically managing it all at once. That's where the real value becomes. Keeping in mind that depending on where you are, if you've got a lot of renewable resources and your utility rates, we talked about time of use rates, 2 years now in California, Matt talked about, in other parts of the world, you'll start seeing that. Is that by knowing that, how do you completely manage, whether it's an old architecture or a new one, everything within that space and dynamically manage it? And not only just dynamically manage it, also have visibility of where all those locations are and network them all from an enterprise point of view. So those are important criteria to have. And even if you look at that, out of the annual supermarket, the entire supermarket, 71% of the energy spend is within the HVAC. And we know that the centralized systems that are most popular architecture out there, they have some challenges because there's a lot of miles of pipe, there's thousands of joints, there's, especially the older systems, you've got parts of suction lines that are uninsulated, the insulation's cracked or it's never been there in the first place, and they're the highest leak rates. There are ways of getting those leak rates down, leak rate reduction programs and tools around to do that, to try to reduce that to below, you know, way below that. I mean, EPA, I believe, says it's below green chill, below 8%, the green chill members. So it is obviously doable to be able to do that. But those other systems typically have a lot of parasitic losses associated with them. The older systems may have a lot more flash gas and liquid lines, which causes efficiencies at all those expansion valves. I mentioned the insulation, condensing pressure swings if they're not properly set. Your liquid quality changes, your expansion valves are hunting, and everything is off balance. Excessive compressor cycling, and so on. There's a lot of things there that cause parasitic losses in a store. It's trying to capture that and do something about it. We went to a store, depending on what your store looks like, whether this particular one didn't do a lot of maintenance, that can cost a lot of money in energy as you go down there. So when you look at old infrastructures, it's interesting because over time, you've got a piece of equipment that was installed, and if it was installed 20 years, it had X efficiency at that point in time. And as time goes on, of course, you know, the installation, adjustment changes over time, maintenance over time, your efficiency could start to continuously drop if it's not completely maintained properly. And then you get to a point where you say, well, my efficiency is much lower than it used to be. I have to do something about it. And you bring it back up to where it was 20 years ago. There's ways of increasing that by adding some capital upgrades to it. And we'll take a look at some capital upgrades coming up. But today, you could buy a brand new system that may be way up there relative to the system that you have because of the IoT components and complete modulation that that system might have. So those are decisions that you need to make. But one of the things that Darren and I talk a lot about is once you get to those capital upgrades and you get to a point where you increase efficiency, the important thing is to hold those efficiency gains and not let them degrade and know that if something's out of whack, you get a notification. Here's a case study that I was involved with, a 20-year-old store, 45,000 square feet, 164 horsepower. There were 10 semi-hermetic Copans in there. And so it was a long program that this particular end user wanted to granularize everything. So it was a great test to start from ground zero and work through every step of the process. So step one, establish the baseline energy of that store. So this is a chart we call Journey to Energy Excellence. We've got energy consumption efficiencies. Well, what are we running now? How is it running today, right now, without making any adjustments? Important to know that. We actually added CTs to it. This is at the Helix Innovation Center. But there's wireless CTs now that you don't have to run the wires all over the store. So it significantly reduces your costs, puts it off to a little router, goes up to the cloud, and you can use that information. So there's ways of doing that more efficient and effectively these days. At this store, we added it basically everywhere. Your compressors, condensed rooftop units, evaporators. And if there's extra refrigeration condensing units, you could have added it to there as well to try to figure out what that baseline energy was. I'm just going to talk about the rack for now, but that's what could have been done. So the important thing is to understand the weather normalized energy signature of the store as it operated just now with all its warts. So figure that out, let it run for X amount of time. X amount of time is dependent on how much ambient temperature variation did you have. If you've got a lot of ambient temperature swings, you can reduce your time to measure data because you want weather normalized energy file to build. If it takes you a little longer to build it, then you run it a little longer. So that's what they did. And then of course, after you modify the store, then you have a delta between those two that you can actually track. That temperature on this store should produce X energy, and you compare. So that's what we tried to do at this particular store. So the first thing we wanted to do is go into that store, and we collected the baseline energy. We went in and just adjusted set points, nothing else. Superheat, head pressure, suction pressure, made sure they were all set. We spent $3,500 changing a board because it was defective. So that was it. 20-year-old store, installed energy equipment to baseline the store. We used the Klimacek equipment to measure that store at that time. Step three, adjust all set points, $3,500, and we reduce the minimum condensing to 70 saturated condensing because it was set a little higher. Step D, use energy monitoring equipment to assure continuous commissioning. So as soon as the readings vary from set point, you get an outlier, you get an alarm, get in there and fix it and find out why you've got an energy outlier. So that's just, we haven't done anything but just adjusted set points. The result was 18% savings. Not just 18% savings and walk away and go home and don't look at it. We held the savings for 12 months. That was super important to this end user because he really wanted to understand, if I'm going to invest in technology, I want to know that once I save energy, I can hold those energy gains and not lose them as soon as I turn around and the tech comes in and maybe doesn't matter. It can vary. It was 162,000 kilowatt hour savings. So that was a big deal. Now we're going to look at the compressors. There were digital compressors. No, they were discus Copan compressors on there. So we retrofitted the discus to a digital. Now, if you don't know what digital is, just you're unloading that head. It's a 3D compressor, so all three cylinders unload at the same time. So either you're operating mass flow, 100% mass flow, or zero mass flow within a time period. Typically, it's 20 seconds. So a 50-minute duty cycle, it pumps for 100% for 10 seconds, and it doesn't. There's no mass flow for the next 10 seconds. And it's on the rack. So that's how we modulate the capacity. Because our discus compressors are already VFD ready. Almost nobody knows that. But our discus compressors have been rated for variable speed drives for many, many years, 25 hertz. But we decided to go digital. Because of the digital, this is not the store. It's a digital example of the value of digital. Many, many stores without digital, just standard 15, 20 horsepower compressors. In this particular rack, we had a 2D compressor, a 3D, and a 6D. As soon as we activated this digital, you can see the dramatic reduction in suction pressure swings. Went from 72 pound peak-to-peak swings to 8 pound differential in peak-to-peak swings. That means your average suction floated way up. And you can see the compressor cycling, the contactor life would dramatically be improved because cycling was dramatically reduced from 100 starts per day at this store to 12 in 4 days. And they're not all like that, mind you, but this particular one was. Digital upgrade to medium temp and low temp. So we said, okay, we've got compressors. Which one do we identify? Just don't just grab any compressor. So with the temperature monitoring equipment, the power, the CTs and the temperature equipment, we identified that there were two compressors on the rack, that one on the low temp was running very, very hot, and one on the medium temp was running very hot. So we took both those compressors off, put digital discus compressors in those applications. The customer did not want to just activate digital right away. He wanted to say, what's the effect of changing a compressor from one that's running hot to brand new one? Brand new one that came through the wholesale. It's brand new spec, but through the wholesale. The impact was 4% energy savings just by changing that compressor. And we ran it for a whole month, so we didn't just run it for a day and say it's 4%. We wanted to find out how long can we track that energy efficiency gain. Then we activated the digital on both the medium temp and low temp and showed an additional 12% savings. Because now you've got the digital making up all capacity differences, and you can keep your suction pressure elevated. And the higher you keep your suction pressure, the lower your compression ratios, the less energy you use. And that was the whole point, purpose behind it. Unfortunately, this test pretty much ended there because they ended up converting that store to a 2-transcritical site. But the next step was to actually change the condenser and change the motors on the condenser and do every step to understand the true energy implication of everything they did so that the other 1,000 stores they had, they know exactly what the impact would be of every change they did. That never occurred. But the digital discus alone ended up giving them a 16% energy savings, which is about $17,000 in savings at that particular site. So, and these are actual graphs of that store. This year, low temp, it went from 30 pounds to 31 pounds in suction pressure. The medium temp went from 58 pounds average to 68 pounds, a 10 pound increase. It's about 2% energy saving per PSI increase, rule of thumb. So it's pretty close. And there was the actual savings I talked about, 122,000 kilowatt hours that they were able to maintain. From the third party that actually did the monitoring for that, which was the Climatech, Rentechnic, actually, it was a third party, ESCO, that did it. And in this particular case, simple payback with incentives, 0.7 years, and without incentives would have been 1.3 years on that particular application. Other refrigeration upgrades, click and collect. We heard about click and collect earlier, that you may have an existing infrastructure store that now you're going to add click and collect. And now you've got to add some walk-in boxes. And it's interesting that you would think that, I don't know if you've seen this chart, but we've heard some of these numbers before. Today, out of the $800 billion U.S. supermarket spend, it's about 4%. To go to 20%, will it go 20%? Who knows? But what we do know is there's a lot of walking coolers and cases that are being installed in supermarkets today. And, you know, a lot of them are, of course, the millennials and the Generation X, but even I've ordered some, so I fall into the boomer section. But right now, there's about 32 to 35% of grocers that have that, and that will continue to grow. And Emerson's done, our engineering department has done detailed studies to understand the impact of, you know, a high-volume walk-in box application. You know, a typical walk-in box, how often is it opened in a supermarket? You guys know more than I. I don't know, is it 5 to 10 times a day? All day? All day. I got the boxes stuck in the door. That doesn't count. But if it even has a door, yeah. But these types of applications, you can have up to, on a busy weekend, something coming up, you can have 200 orders a day. So they're going in this freezer and walk-in cooler 200 times a day, potentially. And when we were there looking at it, you walk in there and you go, beer, they'll even put stuff in there that's normally refrigerated. It's in the normal aisle, but when they're staging it, they throw the beer in the cooler. There's extra load you didn't count on, plus all the other groceries. What is causing is extra humidity buildup and water on the floors and potential hazards for employees. So it's a different strategy. And Emerson's worked hard on our CFD model to really enhance our understanding of the sizing and loading of these boxes and the humidity infiltration into those spaces. Predictive elements, we're developing some predictive elements for the end users. You know, allow better moisture infiltration and shelving design to understand that. Enhance down models. We're spending a lot of time calculating better pull down models so you don't have food quality issues or food safety. If you're going in there 200 times a day, you need extra redundancy of equipment and pull down capacity to manage that, which is super important. You know, this just happens to be an algorithm that we've developed for the transport space. Earlier on, we heard about the unique nature of transports. You got thousands of containers, and they've got refrigeration equipment on there, and you don't want to just load that refrigeration container and just send it off without having a health check of the system. So there's a lot of technology and a lot of manipulation of data analytics that are coming around. This happens to be 276 systems that we measured the health index of the compressor, of the temperature. We know what it should be. We know what we're getting. And you get an outlier and you say, okay, you need to do service on, you know, container 14, 312, and 625 before it gets loaded and shipped out again. Hugely valuable. But it's taking this type of data analytics and transferring it to the walk-in, high volume, and supermarkets as well, which is super important. As you go down, now every single time we did something, the energy starts dropping, the hours start dropping. So that's important. If you attended Danny's session, they talked about RTU upgrades and demand ventilation and humidity control as another means of dropping that kilowatt hour overall just a little bit lower, whether it's a new installation or a retrofit. There's huge opportunities there. But anyway, there's a huge opportunity, of course, in the rooftop market, not only in retail, but also food retail, and the importance of integrating all that equipment on the roof with the refrigeration equipment that's in the store, and again, managing it as an ecosystem. And being able to try to flexibly control that is hugely important going forward. You know, and there's other things that you can do going forward as far as reducing that kilowatt hours and maybe even peak kilowatt. And that Matt talked about that this morning in the energy section. It's, yeah, you can be adding doors. You can be adding electronic valves and case controls to the cases. You can be ECM motors, the evaporators and condensers and floating head and all that stuff. And there's also cold energy, cold thermal energy storage that's an option, and that talked about too, is how do you get to the next step of reducing peak demand? So here's the, I have a case study that we had done in Canada when I was there. We converted, this is a, happens to be a drugstore. A lot of drugstores, like in the US, have refrigeration. And they had all open deck cases here. 36 feet of dairy, large temperature swings in those cases, latent pain, product quality, and shelf life. They just thought it was what it was. So then they decided, well, we're going to add doors to this. So that's what they did, add doors to those 36 feet of case. They replaced a 10-horsepower compressor with a 5-horsepower digital scroll that can modulate even lower. And we added a digital controller to that condensing unit. What they found was more than 60% reduction in energy, and that was measured and verified by a third party so that they can get their utility rebates. They had tighter temperature controls, of course, because they had doors. That makes a whole lot of sense. But they also found warmer aisles increased dwell time. The store manager found that people were standing in front of there now and spending more time picking and choosing instead of grabbing and running because it was too cold with the air conditioning in the cases. So, and you know, from the contractor benefit point of view, he had opportunities to leverage that and try to sell it and talk about it to other areas. But one of the things that was mentioned this morning from a kilowatt savings point of view is how do you shave those kilowatts at the highest peak time of the day? And there's three, not the only three, but three in the refrigeration industry that we know a little bit more about. There's a couple of these systems installed in California right now. One of them is called Axiom Exergy, not energy. And really what they're doing is you have thermal storage tanks, which is a salt solution. You have a system integrator, which has a compressor, pumps, heat exchanger in here. And then you have your refrigeration system over here. And all you're doing is basically, they term it, it's like adding another case to your rack. They add a suction line to the integrator. You add a liquid line to the liquid line manifold. Here's your compressor, and that's your condenser. And at night, when energy is the lowest, and your ability to float your head pressure down, even in California, it's cooler at night, take advantage of those lower energy costs and lower head pressure, you basically chill this salt solution to about a minus 17 degrees. And when you get to a hot middle part of the day where you're paying peak energy prices, you turn the medium temp compressors completely off. And now that suction medium temp gas comes into the suction header. It gets condensed in this integrator by this cool 5 degree, -5 degree Fahrenheit salt solution. It condenses that liquid. There's a pump that pumps the pressure back up to the liquid manifold, and it pushes the liquid out to all the cases. It'll run for 6-8 hours, depending how large the case is. So that's how they turn compressors off in the hottest part of the day in the medium temp to avoid those peak kilowatt charges. That's one strategy. Viking Cold, Matt talked a bit about Viking Cold today. So you've got these blue, you know, the freezer packs like you have at home, the PCM material, phase change material in them. They're all lined up at the top of your freezer, and you charge them at night, drop the temperature in them, and when you need to shift, you turn your compressor off, and natural convection keeps that temperature within that cooler at the right point. So there's a kilowatt hour component, and there's a kilowatt component for peak as well. And the last one, also, Matt talked about rebound technologies is more geared to industrial, but it's all about you can actually help massively subcool your liquid for blast freezing by only using your compressor to a 32 degree freeze point, so you're not working at minus 20. You're just making ice. And that chemical mixture with the ice drops the temperature of combined ice in that mixture that allows you to subcool liquid to a very low temperature and get more enthalpy and pull down faster. So that's one. That's another strategy for energy saving. Not so much supermarket. The other two would be more freezer, medium temp for kilowatt reduction. So when you look at the ecosystem again, from an upgrade point of view, there's a lot of things to think about. Of course, you've got to meet refrigerant regulations. If you're retrofitting a gas, the HFO blends, what's the right HFO blend for you in what region, and understanding the mitigation that you need to do around that. That's important. Understand the power dynamics in your area, the charges, and try to forecast where it's going. And if you know where it's going, then you can actively try to incorporate as many strategies possible so you're not paying through the nose for energy. And the other thing that's super important to me, and the difference between two simple words, effective versus efficient. You know, a lot of us think that just because our systems, I have no alarms, everything's working great, everything's effective, everything's at temperature, everything's good. But you might be running 15, 20% more energy. It's not efficient, but it's certainly effective. And how do you take both of those and combine them together? You want it to be effective for food quality and food safety and all those good things, but you also need it to be efficient so that you can remain profitable. And trying to tie all of this ecosystem into one through an enterprise service network and take advantage of, if you can take advantage of utility programs and think of your operation as, how do I turn this inflexible, seemingly inflexible energy asset into a flexible one so that the utility pays me to shift if I can within reason, then that can be super valuable to an end user. And I can tell you in talking to with James and talking to program developers, this is new to them. Program developers for utilities are looking for our help on helping them develop these things because it's new. They've done the lights and they've done this and that, and it's seemingly such a complicated space that no one's really delved that much into it. There are some ESCOs that specialize in it, yes, but as a whole, an industry, it certainly is something we can take advantage of. Thank you very much for coming, and have a great evening.